Yeah, so in the last class we have done with the three phase circuits. Today in this class we will be moving to single phase transformers. Okay. So in this class we will be seeing this is the first electrical machine that we will be dealing with today. Okay. There are four electrical machines, general electrical machines that we have in our electrical science. Which are there for your study: transformers, induction motors, synchronous generators or alternators, and DC machines, both DC motor as well as DC generator. Okay, so these are the four machines we study, which are the applications of electrical science. So what all we have studied so far, that we apply the concepts what we studied so far, we will be applying in these machines to understand their operating principle, to understand their construction, why the construction is so and so, to understand their behavior, to understand their performance. Okay, but for your syllabus the contents are very much limited. Here we study only the fundamental operating principle of each of every machine I mentioned. We study the construction of the each of the machine I mentioned, and small some performance parameters. We will not go in detail with any machine. Okay, so to start with the transformers, I thought of starting directly what is given in the syllabus, construction and all. I hope you know what is the construction of transformer, how is the construction of transformer, what is the fundamental principle it operates with. What I thought is, instead of directly jumping into the content, what is there given as per the syllabus, we will see some fundamentals of electromagnetics or electromagnetism before we go into the actual study of the syllabus part, is what is there in the transformer part. Okay, unfortunately, in your syllabus of basic electrical engineering, there is no electromagnetism part. Okay, so from 2015 onwards that part has been taken out from the actual syllabus. Okay, so I thought I will take some time to discuss with on the electromagnetism. Okay, what is magnetism, what is electromagnetism, how the electromagnetism is useful for us. Okay, to a small extent we have studied about inductance and all those things in single phase circuits. This is the application of inductive nature of the system, or capacitive nature of the system, which we rarely come across. Usually we come across inductive nature of the system. Okay, so we'll start with the single phase transformers. And I will start with the fundamentals of electromagnetism. After we go through these fundamentals, we will go to the actual syllabus that is there in the portion. Okay. So, topic is single phase transformer. We'll see what is transformer, what is single phase, what is three phase transformer, where these are used, everything we'll see. First we'll see the basics of electromagnetism. Because this electromagnetism concepts are necessary for us for every part of the syllabus hereafter. Okay, without understanding the concepts of electromagnetism, it is a little bit difficult to understand the you can say operating principle or the behavior of the systems what we are we will be looking into hereafter. Okay, so what is magnetism? First we will very briefly, all of us, we have played with magnets when we were young. We have played with magnets. We used to take magnetic pieces and we used to attach to them iron filings, and after some time of attachment those iron filings or iron pieces or needles or pins would also should also become the magnets. They also started behaving as magnets. So what is magnet or magnetism? Simply it is a property of directive nature. Okay, it will direct. Okay, it will direct the things which will come under its influence. So if I put any magnetic material in the magnetic field, that magnetic material will get oriented or directed. Okay, so when I take an iron needle near to the magnet, either it will get attracted or it will get repelled. Now if iron needle is magnetically neutral, definitely it will get attracted. If iron needle is magnetically polarized, then either it will get reflected or it will get repelled or it will get attracted, depending upon its polarity with respect to the magnet. And we know that any magnet are having two poles, okay, north and south. Okay, so there is no unipolar magnet in existence. The magnet always occur, or the magnetic field always occur with a dipoles. That is, one will be north pole, one will be south pole. When I cut the magnet into two pieces, automatically dipoles are formed. Okay, we know this already, we have studied in our high schools. Now if this is north, this is south, and when I cut this, okay, this will become south, this will become north. Okay, so this is the nature. Okay, the nature itself has given the nature to this magnet to have dipoles always. Okay, and that is a natural magnet. I can have a natural magnet Fe3O4, okay, ferric oxide. Okay, so that we will be using, that is the natural magnet what we have. But a natural magnet is having certain limitations. For our application, if I want to have a large energy storing, okay, if I want large energy storage applications, my natural magnets are not sufficient to have the large magnetism requirement. Okay, so in that case, if I want a large magnetism requirement, then I should be using bigger natural magnets. Automatically the system becomes very large in size, large in weight, also it becomes very much costly. So for that we will go for the electromagnets. Okay, so electromagnet these are completely based on the electricity. Now take a simple wire. Okay, we have all done this activity. We took a needle or a nail, surrounding that we wound a copper wire and we connected it to a battery. Okay, then when the battery was closed, the current started flowing. Okay, when current started flowing, this nail started operating as a magnet. Okay, now it started attracting the iron pieces surrounding it. So this is an electromagnet. Now suppose this is the magnetic field surrounding this. Okay, now if I want to increase the space of magnetic field, if I want to increase the area of magnetic field, then instead of giving a small battery, now connect a larger voltage source. Then current will be increased, then my magnetic field area will be increased. Whereas with natural magnet, control of magnetic field is not that easy, because if I have to control the magnetism of the magnetic field, then there I have to vary the size of the natural magnet, which is not so easy once it is fabricated. But whereas in electromagnet, I can have the magnetic field to any extent I want. But obviously there will be an upper limit for every current carrying conductor. To that limit, at least I can vary the magnetic field. I can make magnetic field zero also. I cannot make magnetic field zero suddenly with the natural magnet, because natural magnet is having implicit magnetism. It will be having its own magnetism wherever I keep it. But if I simply disconnect the current flowing through this coil, automatically my magnetism also becomes zero. Okay, so electromagnet is one of the most advantageous magnet or the source of magnetism or magnetic energy that I make use of into building my machines. Okay, there are two systems where we can store the energy, because all the machines, electrical machines, operate on energy storage principle, okay, or energy conversion principle. Okay, so for this, all electrical machines use inductances, okay, or coils. Now there are two concepts. One is electromagnetism and electrostatic. Because electromagnetic system will also store energy, electrostatic system will also store energy, then why don't I have electrostatic systems? All I have electromagnetic systems. You take a motor in the fan, you take a motor in your mixer, you take a motor in your grinder, you take a motor in your vehicle's armature, you take motor anywhere, that is electromagnetic. You take transformer anywhere, that is electromagnetic. You take generator anywhere, DC, AC, small generator, large generator, generators in our houses or our shops, generators in our shopping complexes, which are acoustic generators. You see a green block near to all big buildings, that is a generator. Or you take generators which are in megavolt ampere rating or megawatt rating in the generating stations. All are electromagnetic systems. Then why don't I build, or why didn't I build it from centuries to the electrostatic systems? It is because of energy density. Okay, all the systems what we observe are electromagnetic. Electrostatic systems are very, 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 very less. Okay, why? Because the energy density of electrostatic system is very limited. So energy density, electrostatic system, okay, is having energy density of simple 40 joules per meter cube. If I create a electrostatic field, okay, you know how to create electrostatic field. Simply, for example, very simply, you consider a capacitor. Okay, now if I consider a capacitor, between the plates of capacitor is electrostatic field. Now if electrostatic field is of 1 meter cube volume, 1 meter cube means 1 meter, 1 meter width, 1 meter depth, and 1 meter height. 1 meter, 1 meter, and 1 meter. This is 1 meter cube. If this is the electrostatic field, it can store the energy of just 40 joules of energy. Okay, so if I create an electrostatic field of 1 meter cube volume, it will store 40 joules of energy. That's it. Now what about electromagnetism? Electromagnetic system, okay, its energy density is you simply cannot imagine how large it is. It is 40 joules per meter cube. It is 1 megajoules per meter cube. 40 joules per meter cube is electrostatic system's energy density, whereas electromagnetic system is having 1 megajoules energy density, m megajoules per meter cube. Now if I create a electromagnetic field of 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter, suppose this is a room of 1 meter, 1 meter and 1 meter. Okay, if I create a magnetic field in this room of 1 meter cube volume, then the energy density or energy stored is 1 megajoules. Whereas if I create a electric static field, energy stored is only 40 joules. See the ratio. If you take 1 mega by 40 joules, it is almost 1 mega only. Because 40 is nowhere comparable with respect to 1 mega. So if I want to build a electrostatic system that gives the same output as that of electromagnetic system, then my electrostatic system will be 1 mega times larger than my electrostatic system. Now suppose if you want to have the same output of a fan, roughly, may not be exactly, roughly. if I want to have the same output of the ceiling fan in your house, okay, with which you want to operate on the operating principle of electrostatic energy storage, then the size of the fan may be of your room only. Okay, so it takes large amount of space to get the same amount of output or to same amount of energy storage that what the electromagnetic system will charge, store. Therefore, every machine we observe in electrical science or electrical field or electrical machine in general is always electromagnetic. I don't go electrostatic machines because energy density is very low. It means that to obtain the same output as that of electromagnetic system, my size of the machine should be very large per meter cube. See, the volume of the machine will be very large, simple. Okay, so therefore, anywhere we see the electromagnetic systems. That is why electromagnetism is one of the very, very, very important topic to be understood in understanding the electrical science. But unfortunately, that has been taken out from your regular syllabus, which are points, those are very important for us to understand the nature of the machines and other contents of the syllabus I will be dealing with. Okay. Now, how an electromagnet field is created? Now, we know that I can control electromagnetic field very conveniently simply by controlling the current. Now, how the electromagnetic field is created? It is very simply, you know, when I take a conductor and I make this conductor to carry current, then this current carrying conductor will create a flux surrounding it. Okay, a current carrying conductor will create a flux surrounding it. So the direction of flux is this. It will create a flux with this direction of motion. How this is given? Right hand thumb rule. Okay, I think this you have studied in 12th standard or PU second or first, where you studied the electromagnetism for the first time, or magnetic effect of electric current. That was the, I think, topic. Okay, so there you studied that whenever a current is carried by any conductor, that conductor will create some magnetic flux surrounding it, and the direction of magnetic flux was given by right hand thumb rule or Cork's screw rule. Okay, now if I hold a conductor in such a way that the direction of thumb indicates the direction of current flow, then the direction of other fingers indicate the direction of flux. This is what right hand thumb rule is. Okay, so when I know the direction of current in any conductor, very conveniently and easily I can get the direction of flux surrounding it. So we know by nature now, when any conductor carries current, it will create a flux. Now I can say that the flux created by the conductor is always proportional to the current carried by the conductor. Okay, is always proportional to the current carried by the conductor. Now, to remove the proportionality constant, what we have? Phi is equals to L into I. Now, what is this L? It is the self inductance. Self inductance of conductor. Okay. Now, how to know whether the conductor carries or is having or it is possessing self-inductance? That is already decided at the time of fabrication of the conductor. Now, whether that conductor should have self-inductance or it should not have self-inductance. Now, if the self-inductance of the conductor is zero, then that conductor, even if carries current, it won't create any flux. Okay, so to create the flux by the conductor should be inductive in nature. It should have its own inductance. Then only that conductor is capable of carrying current. So inductance is nothing but a capability of a conductor to create a flux. not exactly the definition of inductance, but it is the property by which a conductor or a coil, when carry current, can create a flux, can produce a flux. If inductance is not there, then it won't create a flux. So inductance is the fundamental quality of my electromagnet. If inductance of that wire is zero, then that wire cannot form any electromagnet. The best example for this is our rheostats. We use rheostat in our labs. The rheostatic wire is pure resistance, where the inductance of that rheostatic wire is made zero at the time of fabrication itself. So when a current is carried by the rheostat, it won't create any flux around it, because the inductance of that wire is made zero. So to have any current, so to have any flux created by the current through any conductor, that conductor must possess inductive property. Okay, so this is the first requirement of electromagnet. Okay, so phi is equals to L into I, sorry, phi is proportional to I, and phi is equals to L into I. Okay, now if I keep this conductor straight, I will get some quantity of magnetic flux. Now if I want the same quantity of magnetic flux, if I want increased quantity of magnetic flux by the same amount of current in the same conductor, then instead of keeping this conductor straight, I will wind this conductor on some core. So I will take some core here and this core must be compulsorily magnetic in nature. I cannot take a wood and I wind it around. It won't help. Okay, it should be magnetic in nature. Then I will keep this conductor in the form of a coil surrounding this. Okay. Now if I pass the same amount of current I through this coil, then the electromagnetism or the magnetism surrounding this coil will be much larger than the magnetism surrounding this conductor. Now if the same conductor is now stretched into the straight wire and pass the same amount of current through it, my magnetism produced is much lesser when compared to magnetism produced by this coil. So always when I want to have electromagnet, I keep my conductor in the form of a coil. So hereafter, whether I call it as a conductor or whether I call it as a coil, those both are same. I interchangeably use the names coil and conductor hereafter. You don't get confused. Okay. Now why I use coil? Because when I keep the conductor in the form of a coil wound on something which is magnetic in nature, the magnetic flux produced is much larger. Now why it has to be larger? See, this forms one conductor. Okay, now this is carrying current. This will carry current. This will carry current. Now if you consider, each conductor is now in a turn is carrying current. There is a flux produced here. There is a flux produced surrounding each turn. This one wind is called one turn. So each turn is producing flux. Okay, each turn is producing flux, and observe, all the fluxes produced by all the turns are in same direction. Therefore the fluxes will add up. When the fluxes are in same direction, fluxes will add up. Therefore the total flux produced is simply multiplied by number of turns. Now if the flux produced by this conductor is, say, phi, when carrying the same current I, the flux produced by this coil when carrying the same current is proportional to number of turns. Okay, flux produced by this turn plus this turn plus this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 turns I have. So this flux produced will be 8 times, okay, or you can take phi dash, okay, flux phi dash is 8 times the flux. Flux produced is 8 times the flux. Now, the flux is proportional to current. This flux phi is proportional to current. Now, I will write phi dash is proportional to 8 times the current. See, the current I is same whether the conductor is stretched straight or it is having multiple turns. The magnitude of current I is same. But the effect of current speed is 8 times because I wound the conductor into 8 turns. Now what is this 8? It is a turn. Okay. So this phi dash is now proportional to, let us take n into I. What is this n? N is a turn. Number of turns in an electromagnet. Number of turns in an electromagnet. Okay. So this flux phi dash is now proportional to what? N into I. What is this N into I? It is called ampere turns. So this flux in any coil is proportional to ampere turns, and this ampere turns is nothing but, this is nothing but MMF. It is nothing but MMF. What is MMF? Magnetomotive force. Magnetomotive force. Like I have electromotive force in electrical circuit, which is responsible for the flow of current in any electrical circuit, which is the forcing function for any electrical current in electrical circuit. Like that, magnetomotive force or MMF or ampere turns is responsible for creation of flux. So if I have to create the flux in any coil, then I should be having number of turns and amperes. Now if there is a coil and I don't pass current into it, my amperes become zero, flux produced becomes zero. Now if I retrieve the current, if I take out the current from this coil, my flux produced by this coil will be zero. Now if there are no turns, even if there is one conductor, it is one turn. Please remember, okay, if I can consider it as one turn, if possible. No turns means what? There is no conducting path. So there is no conducting path for the current. Therefore, flux produced electromagnetically is a zero. So if I have to create a flux electromagnetically, I need amperes and I need turns. That is, I need ampere turns. Okay, it is exactly analogous to voltage or EMF in an electric circuit. Okay, so as per Ohm's law, you have seen any current in closed path for in a circuit is directly proportional to the potential difference across that circuit. So there I wrote I proportional to V, current proportional to EMF, flux proportional to MMF. Then I wrote here I is equals to 1 over R into V. This is what? Resistance. So resistance is the property due to which there is opposition offered to the flow of current. Exactly the same way I will write flux is equals to MMF or ampere turns, AT is ampere turns, divided by, like resistance is opposing for the flow of current in electric circuit, there is one opposition, there is one villain here for the creation of magnetic flux, we call it as reluctance. Now compare I equal to V by R, flux equal to MMF by reluctance. Okay. If the reluctance of the magnetic path is more, flux produced in that magnetic path is less. Now reluctance of air is more because it is non-magnet. So any non-magnetic substance is having very large reluctance. It is like an insulator. You take wood, rubber, air, glass, all these are insulators where the resistance is very high, so the creation of current in these materials is very difficult. I need very large amount of voltage if I have to conduct these insulators. Now if I have to push the magnetic flux into the non-conducting or non-magnetic material, then also I need large amount of MMF. Okay. So this is the analogous view of magnetic circuit or magnetic system with respect to electrical circuit or electrical system. Okay. So what we understood so far from this content is, to create a flux electromagnetically, I need current and I need turns. Nowhere in my system I use a straight conductor to create a flux. Always I use a coil to create a flux. So when I keep the conductor in the form of a coil, then turns will come into picture. So therefore, to create a flux, I need amperes and I also need turns. So the flux produced in any system electromagnetically is always proportional to these ampere turns. Always proportional to ampere turns. Okay. So MMF is the main reason to create a flux. Like voltage is main reason to create an old current. Okay, so this is about very fundamental aspect of magnetism in relation with electricity. Okay, so next we'll move to Faraday's laws. Already we have discussed this Faraday's laws in single phase generation of single phase AC. We will re-look into it. Okay. Faraday's laws. Of electromagnetic induction, EMI. Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. Okay. So there are two laws defined by Michael Faraday. Because of him, today electrical science is so vastly existing, so usably existing. Okay. So first law states, or first law, Faraday's first law, Faraday's second law, or I can take first law and second law only. So what does first law states is, okay, see, when we have to remember the laws and rules, it is always useful if we exactly understand the physical phenomena what the laws is intending to explain or state. Please don't remember the laws or rules by hearted with respect to the words those are given in the statements. It is hazardous. Out of my experience, I am telling you, many students write these laws and rules invertedly. Like I have mentioned you, when you defined Ohm's law, V equal to IR, voltage is proportional to current. Many of you told in the class, when I asked what is Ohm's law in the first class of basic electrical, many of you told voltage is proportional to current. Yes, that is true. Voltage is proportional to current only when I am considering the voltage drop across any system or any component. But when I am defining first how the current itself is there in the system, then that statement goes wrong. I cannot define the Ohm's law, fundamental statement of Ohm's law, as voltage proportional to current. The current definition, correct definition of Ohm's law is current proportional to voltage between the conductor ends. Okay. So that is how we have to first understand what the law is or the rule is intending to state or explain. So Faraday's first law will give us, okay, what it states is, it states how an EMF is induced electromagnetically. So this we should remember first, how EMF is induced electromagnetically. And what does second law give? How much is the EMF induced electromagnetically? How much is EMF induced electromagnetically? Okay, and this is strictly applicable to only electromagnetic system. Okay, nowhere else it is applicable. Now, what does first law states? How an EMF is induced? Whenever there is change in the flux linking to a coil, EMF is induced in that coil. Simple. You can use your own words. There is no compulsion to use the same phrases or words that Michael Faraday used in his first paper or first article when he published the statement. Okay. If you understood, even if you use your in your own words, then the statement will be clear. Okay. So what is first law? Whenever flux linking to a coil. Now I will not use a conductor, I will use coil, because here after nowhere I am using as a conductor, I am using as a coil. Whenever the flux linking to a coil changes and EMF is induced in the coil. Okay. And EMF is induced in the coil. Second, how much is the EMF induced? Now see, in the first statement, three things are important. First, there should be flux. Second, there should be coil. Okay. Third, that flux should be linking to the coil. Okay. Coil is there, that is not, that may not be important point. There should be flux. That flux should be linking to the coil, and that flux must be changing. If I place a coil in the magnetic field, suppose this is my coil, I will place it in the magnetic field and I don't vary the position of neither magnetic field nor the coil, the EMF is not induced in the coil. So only the existence of the requirement will not serve the purpose. There should be work done. There should be a continuous change in the flux that is linking to a conductor. So to induce an EMF electromagnetically, I need flux. Okay, I need flux. That flux must be linking. That flux must be changing. So these are the three points very much important to get an induced EMF in any coil. Next, what is the second law stating us? The EMF induced in a coil is directly proportional to rate of change of flux. That is, E is directly proportional to d phi by dt. Now what do you exactly understand by this? You mugged up this statement in the previous study, you reproduced it in the exam, got marks, good marks, and you finished. But what exactly rate of change of flux mean? Okay, now I showed a small diagram here, I will redraw this here. Okay, now let us take the coil, the same coil. Now I will keep the coil stationary in the magnetic field. There is no change in flux. There is flux which is linking this coil, but there is no change in that flux that is linking the coil. Hence the EMF induced in this coil will be zero. Now if I make this coil slowly moving in this magnetic field, then there is some value of induced EMF, say suppose E. Now if I move this coil at a very faster rate, there is some value of EMF induced, let us take E dash. When I move the coil at a faster speed, okay, or at the higher speed, the flux lines cut by this coil is more when compared to the earlier case when it was moving slowly. This is called rate of change. Okay, so the rate at which the conductor is changing its position in the stationary magnetic field, or the rate at which magnetic field is changing its position with respect to the stationary conductor, both can happen. Okay, so this is called rate of change. So if I move it very fast, the EMF induced in this coil will be more than the EMF induced when the coil is moved at a slower speed. So that is called rate of change. Okay, and this rate of change E is equals to N into d phi by dt, where N is number of turns in the coil. If there is only one conductor, EMF induced is only in that one conductor. Now if there are number of turns, each turn will get an EMF induced in it. Therefore, since the direction of flux is same in for all the conductors, the EMF induced will be same in all the conductors, and all the EMF induced in turn, momentarily I will drop this because this is over. So when this coil will move, each turn is getting EMF induced in it, and since all the turns are connected in series, the EMF induced in each turn will get added up at these two ends. Hence I am adding the number of turns, those are present, there are n number of turns. So therefore EMF induced in any coil is n d phi by dt. So this is how EMF is induced in any conductor. Now the question is, why EMF has to be induced if there is change in the flux linking to a coil? Why it has to happen? What is the reason for that? Why? What is EMF induced means? It is a potential difference. Okay, it is a potential difference. You call it as a voltage, you call it as potential difference, you call it anyway. It is a potential. Okay, so when there is a changing magnetic field linking to a conductor. Linking to a conductor, what is a conductor? Conductor is nothing but accumulation of atoms. Okay, conductor is nothing but accumulation of atoms. And what is atoms made of? Atoms made of the charged particles. So whenever there is change in the magnetic field linking to, if you see very fundamentally, the charged particles, if they are linking to the flux which is changing is now linking to a charged particle. So when a charged particle will experience a change in magnetic field surrounding it, it will get a energy induced in it. That is potential energy. Okay. Now electron will gain some energy. Electron will gain some energy because of changing magnetic field surrounding it. Okay. If you study field theory, you will come across all these things. But field theory is not for the non-circuit branches. Okay, so in that it is very beautifully explained why the EMF has to be induced in a conductor. Okay, when there is change in flux. So when there is change in flux, the electrons present. The charged particles, electrons, because electrons are the ones those are carrying the currents. Okay, so the electrons, when they experience variation in the magnetic field into which they are existing, they start gaining potential energy. The moment I provide them the closed path, that potential energy gained will get converted into kinetic energy in the form of electron flow. That we call it as current. Okay, so current is what? Flow of electrons in a particular direction. When electrons can flow, any electron can come out of its orbit only when it will gain energy. If it doesn't gain any energy from the external source, it will be simply sitting in its orbit. Why electron will come out of orbit when energy is given to it? Because it has to maintain the equilibrium. When electron gains energy, it starts spending that energy. It always try to spend that energy so that whatever the gained energy is there, it will spend it and come back to there to its neutral position or equilibrium position. So to in the hurriedness of getting the equilibrium state, electrons will start flowing like a mad horse inside the bulk of the material. Because it has gained energy, it has to lose it. So to lose it, it has to come out. Where is the path for the flow? The path which a person is giving in the form of a circuit designer. So as long as the external source is there, electron will continue start getting the energy. It will continue start spending the energy. The moment I cut out the external source of energy, electron will stop itself and go to its one of the orbits. Then we say current stopped. Current becomes zero. When I retrieve the voltage, external voltage, the current becomes zero. Okay, so this is the very, very, very fundamental understanding of the charge flow. Okay, if you understand this, more than 50% of electromagnetism and electrical science is understood. Why and how are the two questions which has to be asked when we study any topic for the first time. When we can ask these two questions and conveniently give the answers to these two questions, why and how, then you will be understanding that particular concept in a very, very, very beautiful way. So you need not to read it once again throughout your life. You will simply remember it whenever you want, you will retrieve it. In your own words, you will be explaining it or reproducing it in a very beautiful sentences, in a beautiful way. Okay. So this is the fundamentals of electromagnetism. Along with Faraday's law, there is one more law always defined. Okay, is Lenz law. Okay, so Lenz law. So Faraday's first law gave how an EMF is induced. Faraday's second law gave how much an EMF is induced. Lenz law gives what is the direction of induced EMF. This gives the direction of induced EMF. Direction of induced EMF. Okay. Now what is the statement of Lenz law? The EMF induced in a coil electromagnetically will be in a direction such that it opposes its own cause. So the induced EMF, the direction of induced EMF is such that it will oppose its own cause. What is the cause of EMF induced? The change in flux. Not only the flux, okay, not only the linkage, but it is the change in flux. So EMF induced opposes change in flux. Therefore, induced EMF is given by E is equals to minus N d phi by dt. So, where minus indicates direction. Direction of induced EMF. Okay? So, this is about the fundamentals of electromagnetism and the fundamental laws in electromagnetism. So, based on these Faraday's laws only, all my machines, electrical machines, will be operating. The operating principle may be different in different machines, but in all operating machines, fundamentally the Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction itself are operating. Okay, whether it is an induced EMF or an induced torque or a conducted torque, okay, the principle of operation is electromagnetic. Okay, so in the next class we will actually start what is transformer, its construction. Still small content is remaining, that is self inductance and mutual inductance. That we will see in next class, and after that I will start with the actual transformers. So today, tomorrow we will be starting the actual transformers. Okay, so we'll end here, the session will end here, and I thank you for joining the class. Okay? Thank you.